Oh, maybe this one? Okay, thanks. Yeah, thanks for the introduction and for inviting me. It's a great occasion to talk to the next generation, or over next generation.
Maybe closer to the microphone?
Yeah? Okay, that's better. Okay, great. I think you already introduced me. So the title is Deep Learning for Future Industry. What? Doesn't quite work yet. Should this work? Maybe this thing. Can do it by hand. Maybe. Maybe something. Ah, it doesn't matter. Has it turned on?
Yeah, it is, but I will try to check. I cannot find the signal.
Okay, doesn't matter. But I can work a little bit, so. But the email works? This works. Okay, great, thanks. Before I talk about future industry, I want to talk about past industry. So as you probably all know, in the revival of neural networks happened in the 90s, or late 80s really. And here's some of the really competitive neural networks solution developed at that time. The first one is NetTalk from Zinovsky and co-workers. At that time, he was at John Hopkins. And this was a neural network which learned how to pronounce English. So it was reading text and mapped it to utterances. And it was training for days. And it was covered in the New York Times. It was a great success, great for making this idea popular. And it sounded like a young baby or young child learning how to speak. So that was really impressive. It was not a commercial success, but a really impressive application. Then we all probably know Lunette, the work from Yann LeCun, who was at Bell Labs at that time, then AT&T Research, and then NEC Research, and it's about reading OCR, so handwritten digits. It was hugely successful. He developed the convolutional net at that time, and if you're in deep learning, you probably know about this technology. Another popular application was financial time series modeling and prediction, for example, at prediction company, but also at other companies. Also, there was good work at my company, at Siemens. I think there's still probably a lot of people moving from machine learning into financial business. I think at least three people I know who are in London of my colleagues, former colleagues. At that time, it was really a big thing. And at Siemens, we did a project called NeuroSteel. Nowadays, it would be called maybe in-field analytics. And I want to talk a little bit about that. So, it's not a trivial task. The task was to, so this is a rolling mill here on the right side. And you want to get a certain reduction in thickness. And you want to know which force you have to apply to get that reduction in thickness. So it's a mapping of a lot of parameters, temperature, thickness of the incoming steel, steel properties, chemical properties, and so on, to predict the force which is you have to apply to do the thickness reduction. Of course, after a while, the control sets in, and then the control will fix the thickness. But initially, the control is not active yet. It takes maybe 10 meters of steel until it's really controlled. So you want to know the force before the control sets in. And this was a prediction task. And maybe it sounds like a simple problem, input-output map. But in reality, of course, if you want to really get it to work in industry, there are a lot of important problems to solve. One is data sparsity. We had maybe 200 data points. But you wanted to give some safety guarantees that the neural network didn't predict garbage in areas where there were no data yet. So we used an existing solution as sort of a prior system, which was producing artificial data, which we mixed in with the real data. And in this way, we could guarantee or show that the system was predicting, was doing well prediction everywhere, even in areas where there were no data yet. Jeff Hinton liked the idea, it seems, and he called it at some point priors without prejudice from Pride without Pride and Prejudice. So so that was a very good start. The next big problem. So then other people took over this project. Was online learning. For some reason, the plans change really quickly, and you have to have an adaptive solution to really have good prediction accuracy. And that's something you really want to avoid as much as possible, because you can get all sorts of problems if you do online learning. But these people really solved it. In a very smart way. There's some publications about that. It's sort of a multi-resolution approach where you always like wait until you're sure the next solution is valid before you implement it. But it was very smart. If I talk to people nowadays in control, they're still impressed that this was working. And so you have to imagine 200 plants in the world autonomously adapting to changes. That's pretty impressive, really. Then there's also cold start for a new plant, and so if you go to a new plant, you don't have data, so what do you do? And there are a lot of interesting problems to solve if you really want to get it to work in the real world. And we got a newspaper out of it, and here's a publication of people who took over. And it was really a big commercial success. It made this part of Siemens Automation world leader in this area. And implementations everywhere in the world. And it was also financially a huge success, and made them made the solution made opened a lot of doors for these people. Then you probably also know that in the late 90s there was a neural network sort of crisis. And here, this is my view on things. So do we really know what we were doing at that time? Not really working on understanding the brain and really not learning much from it. And there was this bad notion of second-rate statisticians. We were sort of doing statistical modeling, but we didn't really have a statistical background. We didn't have much respect from other fields, although I must say some of the best statisticians and control experts were quite interested in the performance of these systems. So here's some really famous name in statistics: Hasty, Tip Shirani from Stanford, Leo Bryman from Berkeley, Control Narendra from Yale, Adaptive Control here, Slotin, Batsikas, Tsitsiklis from MIT. So they did really good work, and they were really interested. Another thing often was said: neural networks always produces the second best solution for any problem. Maybe not bad, and it's really impressive to be second best, but of course often you want to be best. So in the late 90s, neural networks became machine learning. Same people stayed in the field, most of them, but the topics changed a little bit. So now it was kernels, Gaussian processes, Bayesian statistics, Bayesian networks, graphical models. Statistical learning theory was further developed. Here, this is Vapnik, who started this development. There was a lot of good theory to be done. So theoreticians liked it because they could prove a lot of interesting theorems. And also suddenly other research fields got enthusiastic about machine learning. Vision, I think, cannot be thought about without machine learning anymore. Bioinformatics, of course, natural language processing, and so on. So everybody was happy again. The crisis was over, but not really too much neural networks left. So this is... there are two projects from my team. First one is Panoratio. It's a company formed out of my team. These are the two key people, Michael Haft and Reimer Hoffmann. The company is in Munich and still exists. It was sort of interactive data mining, where you played with conditional probabilities. And I think everybody loves it. But it's still quite difficult to have a solid business, no? Because if you have 20 people in your company, you need a couple million income every year, and that's a little bit difficult in data mining. It's sort of the solution is similar to ClickView, if you're familiar with that, which is commercially more successful. But at Siemens, we're still using it, so it was a nice success. Another interesting story is about Kai Yu, who was my student. He was got a Siemens stipend at LMU, and we worked together on Gaussian processes and multitask learning. Then he joined after his PhD Siemens Research, then went to NEC Research, and there he learned about deep learning because Yann LeCun was there and he had just left. And then he joined Baidu and became the head of the Institute for Deep Learning there. So Baidu is the Chinese search giant. So I'm very proud of this because he was sort of my student. And he hired Andrew Ng into Baidu, and now he formed his own company this year. So let's see what will happen in the future. So if you're from China, you probably have heard of him. So my research went into a little bit different direction. I always thought something is missing machine learning because it's like a stimulus response type of learning, classification, prediction, and so on. But it doesn't really have a good concept of memory. And three of the main functions in the brain are episodic memory, which is like what happens to you in your life. You remember your own history. Then there's concept memory, that you know about things in the world, dogs and cats and houses and streets, there are subclasses of things. And then there's semantic memory, so maybe that Obama is president of the United States, Munich is in Bavaria, and so on. And it didn't look like this was really something where you could easily apply machine learning to. No? The traditional field here which cares about this type of questions is called knowledge representation. And this field builds on relational databases and knowledge graphs. So maybe in the future we want to have something like this. Deep learning face recognition system discovers that this is Obama, and then it starts a dialogue, and the system has some semantic memory. It knows that Obama is married to Michelle, and then it starts a conversation and asks, so how is your wife Michelle? But for this we need some knowledge about the world. And if you ever looked at knowledge representation, if you're not in the field, it's extremely difficult to understand for outsiders. They typically use a logical language or other things which are not really easy to understand for most people. But fortunately, there's a simple version, called a knowledge graph. And that's exactly the opposite. It's very simple to understand, and it's a really nice thing. And the core thing is this triple here. So entities are nodes in this knowledge graph. So Max is an entity, is a node, and Mary is a node, and they're connected by simple predicates. For example, Max likes Mary, and that's almost it. And you can, of course, there are more things about Max and more things about Mary, and if you connect everything to everything, you get a knowledge graph. So here's an example. This is Albert Einstein. He's born 1879. He's a physicist. A physicist is a researcher. A researcher is an entity. He was born in Ulm. Ulm is a city. City is an entity, or there's some hierarchy here. And Ulm is in Germany. Germany is a state. Albert Einstein can be written as Albert Einstein, could be written as Dr. Einstein. So this is how it works. No? So it's essentially facts about the world, and a little bit class hierarchies, sometimes part of hierarchies, like Munich is part of Bavaria. And this stuff is quite solid. It works quite well. If you try to use more complex background information, it becomes quite brittle. And so I would argue that the ones which are used in real applications sort of stay with this complexity. You know? So here you have a cat, a dog is an animal, a dog one is an animal, cat one is a cat, cats are animals. So you have this type link, you have this subclass link, a little bit more complexity, but really not much more. So it's scalable, and it's a great link between knowledge representation and machine learning, because you know, they like it, and we can understand it. And it brings order into things with surprisingly simple constructs. We're talking about organizing the world or entities in the world, which doesn't seem to be a simple thing. But on this level of complexity, you can get quite far, interestingly. And it's a big thing currently. No? Here you see some examples. And it's first time in history, really, we have this type of large knowledge representations, knowledge graphs. That's pretty impressive. So DBpedia was started in Germany, here by Auer, Bizet, Lehmann, and others. It's closely affiliated with Wikipedia. It's built on information from Wikipedia. Then there's Jago from the Max Planck Institute in Tübingen with Weikum and Suchanek and co-workers. Then there's Freebase, which was bought up by Google, and they made it much, much bigger and turned it into the Google Knowledge Graph. And the Google Knowledge Graph is heavily used in understanding text, in providing information to users, and also in question answering. It's one of the biggest projects at Google, and its API is the second most used after search API. So it's really a big thing. And they invest a lot of people in making this work. Microsoft has Satori, Facebook has an entity graph. And this really scales. No? It's quite amazing. I think they should give credit more to the semantic web community, which these people are from, like DBpedia. But it's amazing, no? that it's really becoming so important. This is another initiative, the linked open data thing. So here, each bubble is a whole database. And you want to interlink them so they know of each other. So they often refer here to the DBpedia, which is the core ontology. So if you want to talk Obama and you want to make clear, you talk about Obama, the president of the United States, you do a link into the corresponding entity in DBpedia. So how do we do machine learning here? So first, what we did is we transformed the graph into a tensor. And a tensor, the way we look at it, is just a generalization of a matrix with more dimensions. So here we have one dimension for the subject. So we have as many indices here as we have subjects. One dimension for the object, and one dimension for the predicate, for the relation. So that's three things. So we get a three-way tensor, very simple. And then we enter a lot of zeros, and we enter ones for triples we know are true and are facts. No? And the zero means either not true or we don't know. So it's extremely sparse. You can store it very efficiently. And then one operation you can do is you factorize the tensor. So if you know matrix factorization, same thing, just for tensors, for multi-way arrays. Then you do limit the rank, and when you reconstruct it based on the factorization, you get numbers back which are not 0 and 1 anymore. And if a 0 wants to become a 1, you think, oh, maybe this fact should be true. And if a 1 wants to become a 0, you say, oh, maybe this is an error, mistake. So this is how it works. And this was really the first paper in this direction. Maximilian Nickel is now a postdoc at MIT. And now there are a lot of different models which have been developed with a similar flavor. One thing is interesting. This is one way you can look at this factorization. Here's the triple. Max likes Mary. And you want to know how certain is this triple. So we have a latent representation of Max, which is just a bunch of numbers, so R numbers, R-dimensional vector. The same for Mary, and the same for likes. So we have three vectors with the same dimensionality describing these entities. And if you apply a tensor factorization, essentially you build sort of a polynomial basis here. So you do products or third order interactions and so on. But it's also quite easy to say, okay, why should I work with polynomials? Sometimes they explode, there are many of them. I can also use a neural network, and we call them multi-way neural networks because they have these three-way inputs. So we train a neural network, and the output of the neural network is then the probability that this triple down here, Max likes Mary, is true or false. So. And it's here in this simple example with triples. We get very good results with the Rascal model, which is the name we gave to this factorization here, a particular way of doing this tensor factorization. We got really good models, but in some sense you get more flexibility if you work with neural networks. For example, if you want to integrate time or other things. So this is sort of my way back into using neural networks, and it was very natural. And it's quite powerful, and I'm quite happy about it. It was not just because it's a hype, it was really the right thing to do. No? Because the neural network can decide which kind of interaction it thinks is useful. In a tensor model, you sort of have to say third order, second order, fourth order, and you don't really want to do that. So it's really elegant. I think there are some interesting comments to make. One is, we are doing inference or inductive inference in knowledge graphs, and you wouldn't think it's a neural network problem. It seems to be very far away from a neural network problem, but if you look at it from the right way, it becomes a neural network problem. There are really interesting applications. This is the one done at Google. So they have a project called the Knowledge Vault. You have to know that the knowledge graph is done essentially by hand. So they have a lot of people taking care of all the information in the knowledge graph. It's about companies, about people, about anything in Wikipedia. So it's a huge, huge thing. But of course, you want to sort of try to automate it. At some point, it doesn't really scale anymore. And the Knowledge Vault is one project where they try to do that automatically. So they're reading a lot of information from the web, text, tables, structures, and they combine it. And then they also do this inductive inference, the way I just described. And so they have two information, this triple, how much evidence do I get from the web, and how much evidence do I get from the knowledge graph itself. And they show very nicely, if you combine these two types of information, you really get a big improvement in accuracy. So that's these people here. So he's quite known, Kapilovich, Murphy, and some co-workers here. So that's really a nice application. Representation learning itself, so working with this type of latent representation, is a big thing in computational linguistics. So here's some names, Golobea, Mikulov, Socher, but also Heinrich Schütze here, who is a professor in Munich in linguistics. And in our case, of course, the latent representations are with the entities and the relation types. The nice thing is with more dimensions, for example, time, you just add another dimensionality, your tensor, you have a four-way tensor, and you just have one more set of inputs to your neural network. Very elegant. We wrote a survey paper on these issues and these technologies with the Microsoft guys, Murphy and Grabilovich, so maybe want to take a look at that. So this is a little bit audacious. So I had to look up what audacious is. Okay, maybe you have to look it up too. So here's, of course, the well-known deep convolutional network where you exploit locality and time and space and combine local features to form flexible, complex patterns to really do a deep classification of cats or faces and so on. This is deep recurrent networks. where you explore locality and time and space and combine local short-term features to form complex long-term patterns by exploiting internal memory. And here is a famous LSTM of Jörg Schmidhuber and co-workers. Here other recurrent neural networks. And in a way, in deep multi-way neural networks, you do also do local predictions, as I just showed you. But since these latent representations are shared globally in the knowledge graph, there's also some global, deep, maybe deep optimization step going on. So if you're interested in modeling relational databases, knowledge graphs, maybe this is something you might get interested in. Yeah, we've applied it to model some medical data. You want to model medical event data, and it was easy to extend it to also include time. So we have a patient model, which describes property of the patient, and event model, which describes everything that happens to the patient. And here we have a memory, which looks at the last latest time steps. And we got quite good results, and we also want to maybe extend it to recurrent systems here and convolutional ideas. But we're quite happy already with the solution we're having. So typically applications here, you want to understand what's going on in your clinical data. You want to predict things, so then you can predict, for example, that this medication should be taken, or this type of blood count will be measured. And the most difficult one is, of course, prescription, which means you want to recommend actions which are maybe different from just the statistics of what is typically done. Because here you get into this problems of confounders, these things you always read in the newspaper. If somebody makes some conclusion about medical things, and then it turns out to be wrong because he forgets some factors. So this is the last thing. We have to be really careful about this. But I think we are quite happy about these models currently, and it's sort of a generalization of this knowledge graph modeling. So this was my path back to neural networks. There are also other interesting things going on at Siemens. This is Hans-Georg Zimmermann. He's also here. And he's stuck with neural networks and did a lot of great work on recurrent neural networks. A lot of application to time series problems. So he leads the team at Siemens. Then here also some people are here, Volker Sterzing. They work on optimization in gas and wind turbines, also using reinforcement learning techniques, recurrent neural networks. Then a new employee, Sigurd Spiekermann, works on deep learning for understanding text with annotated images. He has a project on case analysis and distributed sensor networks. These two students work on these medical decision processes. And here's a collaboration to students also here, Gupta and Jan, with Hinrich Schütze, who is the professor at computer linguistics at the LMU. And it's in the framework of this data science lab we set up with the LMU, it's a collaboration between Siemens and LMU, and other partners will also join. And this project is partially covered in this common collaboration. Also, we are building another funded project, an industrial knowledge graph. These two people here, Andrasse and Uli Waltinger. And of course, in the areas of Siemens where images are important, there's a lot of activity. This is Doren Komanicu. He's really one of the world leading guys in medical image analysis. And he's also now at the conference, which is going on right now here in Munich. He presents a few papers on deep learning. I think it's called Mikai, I think. And we have also other industrial applications of video analysis and so on. So it is sort of moving into the Siemens business, and of course some activities like these first two projects have been going on for many years already, but there's much more happening. So coming back to the future, the question I sort of posed as a title, So what has changed? So one thing definitely is from second best to best. As I said, in the 90s, it was always sort of the second best solution to anything. Now, deep neural networks are the best solutions to many things, and by a big margin. Of course, typically associated with images, face recognition or image annotation. Another fact is that representation learning and deep learning are currently dominating some research areas like vision and computational linguistics. Here it's more representation learning, but it's also connected to deep learning. It's winning a lot of Kaggle competition, so the success is simply stunning. I mean, I guess that's why you're here. It is very visible in the public, at least in the US. And it's associated with AI and also the dangers of AI. So this is Andrew Ng from Baidu. Why computers won't take over the world just yet. I mean, he's a big deep learning person, of course. Here's from Forbes. Also not a solid journal here. Deep learning and machine learning will eat the world. AI and deep learning, the future of everything. Your Nature article. So the public takes notice, of course, because of the successes. I think machine learning is good for many companies because with machine learning you have to quickly come to the point. You really want to see the data, you really want to understand the problem, you really want to solve the problem which maybe makes money. You don't do anything intermediate. Very goal-oriented. You think about the problem first, and then you think of what you need. Other groups first build huge databases, and on the way they forget what problem they wanted to solve. So I like this one. It's very recent. Here's how the implementation of big data initiatives typically goes at big companies these days. An organization deploys Hadoop, hires some data scientists, and waits for magic to happen, but the magic doesn't happen. So here I translated it into deep learning, I don't think it will happen. I think if you want to do deep learning, you know why you want to do it. But it's so recent, that's quite amazing. I mean, deep learning is quantity. It's not that we can do something we couldn't do before, but we can do it better. But that can be very important. For example, here, this postal automation, also a big Siemens business. And if you have, let's say, 80% accuracy, there's no business. It's just too much manual work you have to do. And this stuff is expensive, of course, so you wouldn't automate it. So we're talking about reading addresses. If you're at 90%, 95%, then suddenly you have a business. And moving from here to here can be very, very important. And that's why deep learning is so important. It brings up these numbers to ranges where suddenly some business is possible. It has a great infrastructure, of course. Piano, cafe, torch. You have GPU computing, which makes it very powerful and very fast. Maybe you want to implement it then with field programmable gate arrays. Then the community itself is amazing. There are very many smart people, explosion of ideas and creativity. And it's something for scientists, but also for engineers, because I think engineers want to think in terms of architectures and adding knowledge and adding signals and don't want to look at the math all the time. I think it's really across areas, across research areas. the people are one of the biggest assets here, I think. Only for new industry. So most impact so far has been at Google, Facebook, Microsoft, and these companies. I showed a few of applications at Siemens. But maybe as much as the old industry becomes future industry, machine learning becomes relevant. No? I mean, we're looking at autonomous driving in the car industry. It's quite, has a huge impact there. Audi has a project where they use deep learning for vision. So these standard or old industries are changing really into new industries. Healthcare, I know there's digital health and personalized medicine, which use a lot of machine learning. Industry 4.0 is a big buzzword to get products and automation systems connected to the internet. Big data, IBM Watson. So the established industries are also changing, and in that change, they will need more and more deep learning. And here's some industries which are not standard. Here's Fanuc, which builds robots, invests in deep learning. Deep learning is the future of automation, robotics. Automotive industry. Here, Brendan Fry, who is a great machine learner, applying it to genetic mutations, applications to healthcare. This is a Siemens project where we predict power demand and optimize systems in this way. So it's moving into the other industries as well, I'm convinced. Coming to conclusions, deep learning is without any doubt the most interesting, creative, dynamic, and promising research community today. It will be extremely fascinating to see how things evolve. It's almost more happening in industry than in academia. That's an interesting tension there. We will see. Will it run out of steam? I think success is stunning, is amazing. If you think of it in the greater context of machine learning, I would not worry. I mean, how much deep learning or whatever. These things change, no? But I think the challenges in machine learning are amazing, really interesting, are still there. And in the last 25 years, you still have the feeling each year or each other year you are pioneering something. Right? Look at the work we did with knowledge graphs, learning. And it's new. There was nothing like that before. Or very awkward inductive mechanisms, which didn't really work that well. Okay, maybe they worked a little bit. But still, now you have the feeling, let's look at this problem from this perspective, and you have new research issues. And here's some examples, the time, space, causality, perception, linking with the brain functions, understanding the brain, cognition, AI, smart assistants, online learning, autonomy, stability. Yeah, many challenges. But of course, before it gets too hyped, not each problem is a machine learning problem. If you look at your smartphone, how many problems are solved by machine learning? Probably not many, very important ones. For example, speech recognition, there's one component which is done by deep machine learning. But it's not like it's everywhere. No? So, of course, if you are really skeptical, is there really progress? Are we simply giving old things new names? It's obviously there's quantitative progress, and a lot of different applications have been addressed. But of course, there's also, for example, autonomous driving probably relies extremely on GPS. No? So that was probably the biggest innovation here. And then they do a lot of machine vision, but GPS should not be underestimated. We have more data. We have large databases which collect so many things nowadays, so then you can do more things with more interesting data, of course. With the internet, we have GPUs, so even in the success of deep learning, the learning algorithms are only part of the story, I would think. Then there are the many worries about AI. That's something important to discuss, but don't forget about all the good things we can do. No? Smart cars, saving lives, patients who get the right treatment, people who never get sick in the first place because before the disease breaks out. The sensors already analyze it and take action. The healthcare system can take actions. In the developing countries, there are many ways of connecting people and getting health treatments to the people who need it much more quickly. Better climate models, energy savings, environmental monitoring. It's not just a big threat. It's also a lot of interesting challenges and projects. So will deep learning affect future industry? Maybe no future of any industry without deep learning. We will see. So we are in Rio Rapidos. So I guess this was a picture I got from Siemens, because there's a lot of Siemens automation hidden here somewhere. But okay, thank you very much.